Pikmin again. Pikmin 2 was released on the Nintendo GameCube in 2004 and on the Wii in 2009. At least if you lived in Europe and Japan. If you live in America, you guys didn't get it in 2012, which sucked. After the low sales numbers of the first game, I'm surprised we got a sequel so soon. Quick note, I played the PAL version of this game on the Wii U Virtual Console, meaning there are a few differences between this version and other versions. So a year after the completion of the first Pikmin game in December 2002, Miyamoto confirmed another Pikmin game in development. And that's about it in terms of the development history, not much new. But they did have this ad campaign, which was...
I said with mustard.
Make it two.
Mustard.
Control was good. You can see how good as two commanders lead a planetary treasure hunt in Pikmin 2. With two-player mode, may the best scavenger win. Only for Nintendo GameCube. Rated E for everyone.
Whatever that was. So, the story of Pikmin 2 picks up straight after the first game, where Olimar has left the planet and goes back to Hokkaidate. Once Olimar lands, he finds out that the company he works for, Hokkaidate Freight, is under some financial difficulties, as in, they are basically bankrupt. How did this happen? Well, according to Louis, Olimar's co-worker, he was transporting gold Pikmin carrots and he was attacked by ravenous space bunnies, which has caused the president to take out a giant loan to repay the debt from this loss. He has decided to sell company assets, including the SS Dolphin, the ship you spent the whole of the last game rebuilding, which in my opinion is a great motivator for the game. The loan left to pay is 10,100 Pokos. Olimar drops a treasure in shock, which is worth 100 Pokos, which is worth more than a year's salary apparently, which means Olimar has to take the Hokkaidate ship with Louis to get as many treasures as possible to finish paying the debt from the planet he just left. So off they go to the planet, and Olimar crashes again. Olimar, you're a terrible driver, but luckily this time the ship didn't break, and Louis fell out their ship. Now you must grab Louis and get 10,000 Pokos worth of treasure. Good luck! So the gameplay is the exact same as Pikmin 1 with a few additions. Firstly, the 1 and 2 buttons now have a function. The function is the Super Spicy Spray and the Super Bitter Spray, which you get from bringing these two types of berries back up to your ship. When you press the 2 button, it activates the Super Spicy Spray, which superpowers your Pikmin, making it even better than flowered Pikmin. So if you want something done fast, use this. The 1 button uses the Super Bitter Spray. You use this against enemies, where it turns them to stone. So if you want something easy to kill, use this. And if you want it something easier to kill, use both. We also have new types of Pikmin, but these are a bit different to your common reds, blues, and yellows. First of all, they don't have onions, which means the only way to increase your numbers is to sacrifice your other types of Pikmin into candy pop buds. But where do you find these candy pop buds, you may ask? Well, you find them in caves, aka the worst feature in this game. I hate caves, but I'll get to that at a later point. The new types of Pikmin are whites and purples. These abilities are quite unique as they have multiple. So purples, while being agonizingly slow, are super strong and carrying something counting as 10 Pikmin, as well as being the best Pikmin at fighting because they do 50 damage as well as stunning the enemy, as well as doing 2 times damage when they're latching. So they are the strong Pikmin. While the whites are super fast and poisonous, meaning if you want something to move fast, use whites. While fighting enemies, they're kind of bad as you want them to get eaten to be effective. If you want something killed, use purples. If you want something moved, use whites. But wait, one of the older Pikmin has a new ability, yellow. Since bone rolls can't be carried in this game, they have a new ability, immunity to electric, which makes way more sense than the bone rock rubbish in the first game, as the other two Pikmin were based on elements. Anyway, electric in this game is just... I flippin' hate electric in this game. It is the biggest pile of dog poop. If a Pikmin pixel slightly touches the corner of an electric bolt, poof, they're gone forever. You can have your whole Pikmin army disappear within a matter of seconds, and multiple enemies have electric properties. So the areas, some are heavily based on the original Pikmin game, while others are completely new. The first area is completely new, called the Valley of Repos. When you first arrive here, Louis gets knocked off the ship, as I said before, and you must retrieve him. When landing here, you see a red fighting a dwarf Bulbasaur, and decide to help them. Oh. I forgot to mention this guy. He is the most annoying guy in this game. Every 2 seconds he goes, "Did you know you can proceed to dismiss and recruit with B?" I swear he does this every 2 seconds. It's so annoying. Anyway, you save Louis from the inconveniently placed paper bag. The next day you go down into the cave and discover purple Pikmin and unlock a new area by bringing the spherical Atlas back to the ship, so onto the next area we go. Which is obviously very much based on the first fight from Pikmin 1, and according to Olimar, it is, and it's changed so much in the time he was gone, which from the looks of it was 30 seconds, so it got a new name called the Awakening Woods. To me it looks basically the same, but with a few extra things. Firstly, who the heck are building these new walls? It makes no sense there are a few more brand new electric gates there, and electric gates weren't even in the first game! Anyway, basically the Forest of Hope again with a few new things and a few caves, blue and white Pikmin are found here. This area is something familiar but different, which is great for returning Pikmin fans and new ones alike. Next area is the Protecting Pool, which is based on the Distant Spring, same reasoning as before on why it has a new name, but this area definitely earned its new name. It took me a while to go, "Oh, this is the Distant Spring," while the Awakening Woods is super obvious from the start. Anyway, this is where you find yellows. I like how you have to unlock yellows to get the blues in the previous area, due to having an electric gate in the way of the blue onion. This area is kinda hard due to not having blues when you first land here, so the water is a giant hazard. But after you get the blues, it's a fun area to explore. The fourth area is unlocked by paying off the debt, which includes more story. So, story part 2! After paying off the debt, the day forcibly ends, and you get a cutscene that tells you you're going back to Hokkaido. After blasting off, Olimar realizes that he left Louis behind. How? What? Excuse me? How did you leave Louis behind? He was right there! For God's sake, Olimar. After that whole fiasco, we get these beautiful looking credits. These look amazing. After he met Hokkaido, the president, which I will be calling Chacho because that's what he says when you switch to him, plus Olimar and Louis say their name, so that's what I'm calling him. Chacho notices Louis is gone, so he decides to go back to the planet with Olimar to receive the rest of the treasure and save Louis, adding a new area. No idea how though. The new area is called the Wistful Wilds, which I actually like a lot. The whole autumn aesthetic is really nice, and the place is challenging, but not too challenging, apart from this bloody grind. But I like the new challenge. There's also a treasure here that costs 1,000 Pikmin, which is 100 purple Pikmin, so grinding for that was kind of annoying. Speaking of difficulty... Caves are the biggest new feature in this game. You find them by exploring the overworld and going with your whole squad of Pikmin. Do not go in while your Pikmin are doing things, as all Pikmin that are not in your group will go back to the onion. So make sure all your tasks are done. Caves are split into sub-levels where a floor holds a certain amount of treasure that you have to get. You can't increase the amount of Pikmin in here other than the Candy Pop Buds, which have a limit of 5 transfers in this game. The Queen Candy Pop Bud, a new feature in this game, can turn one Pikmin into 5. Time also stops in cave, meaning you have all the time in the world to get the treasures. Now for some complaints. I hate caves so much. One of my problems is that it feels too long. Having so much to do in a day, to me, feels detrimental to the game design, as the days are longer and does not allow for that stupid in-depth planning from other Pikmin games. For example, in the first game you could grab one ship part, and while transporting that, grab another type of Pikmin and grab another ship part, and do that over and over again, making you feel super efficient. With the time stopping in caves, it doesn't allow you to multitask as effectively. Sure, you can do it in the overworld, but in caves where there's one or two treasures per floor, you can never be as efficient as Pikmin 1. Another problem with caves is they are randomly shuffled. The layout is the same, but the locations of exits, enemy spawn location, and treasure locations are different every time. This does add a little bit of replay value to caves. But it prevents the best players from getting through the caves faster, as it is completely random if the exit is near you or the treasure is close by, meaning the feeling of getting all the treasures very fast and being super efficient is gone, and is replaced by this randomness, which I personally think is a negative change. And my biggest problem with caves is the difficulty. Without the caves, I'd say this game is a little more difficult than Pikmin 1, but adding the caves would make this very difficult. It isn't that fun kind of difficult like Pikmin 1, it is the complete and utter bull kind of difficult. At the start of the game it was a nice challenge and felt like the fun kind of difficult, but after a few caves it became the monotonous and bad kind of difficult. What I mean by this is I've lost so many things that due to things that aren't even my fault. For example, bomb rocks falling from the sky, Wally walks falling from the sky, random mini-boss exploding on every floor, just a bunch of rubbish that feels more like artificial difficulty than actual difficult stuff. Some bomb rocks and enemies don't even fall unless you have Pikmin on you, which is just disgusting. Don't get me wrong, I think they're a good idea in concept, but these three main things bogged it down a bit. I think it would have fit better as a side mode rather than the main game. There are a lot of new and returning enemies in this game, so let's go through a few of them. The Dwarf Bulbul, yes, is the most simple enemy in the game, but I bring this up because of the Piglopedia, which is a new thing that goes through the biology and description of all the enemies and some plants. In the Piglopedia, it says the Dwarf Bulbul is not related to the normal Bulbul at all. It is related to the bread bugs due to some groundbreaking new research. What research? As far as we know, the only people that have been on this planet are Olimar and Louis, and Olimar discovered the planet, and it doesn't even look similar to the bread bugs. A friend of mine redesigned the creature to show what it should look like, so it's similar to the Bulbul, but at least a little similar to the bread bugs. Groins, gotta say it was surprising going down to find a guy shooting me from halfway across the map. My first reaction was, why does he have a gun? Which was a fun time, though I think they overstayed their welcome. It was cool the first few times, but got annoying after a while. Dweevils, these things are just annoying. There are 5 different types of Dweevils, which most are based on each Pikmin type. Fire, water, electric, poison, and bomb. The electric and bomb Dweevils are just mean. The explosive one just drops on you from the sky and carries a bomb rock with them, and chases you blowing up and killing any Pikmin nearby. The other type of Dweevil will pick up the treasure and have you attack them to get the treasure back from it. But when you attack them, they will put a cloud or whatever element they are around themselves. But my problem is with the yellows. If they do their thing, it's unreactable and all your Pikmin die and you have no second chances. Bulbmen. This enemy is a large Pikmin mixed with a Bulbul. When you defeat the big Bulbmen, you can whistle the tiny ones, and that's a new type of Pikmin right there. They are basically red, blue, yellow, and white Pikmin combined, but unlike other types of Pikmin, they are exclusive to caves that you find them in. Unlike pubs and whites, you can't bring them outside the cave, and they are stuck in there. These Pikmin are great as they can up your Pikmin numbers, and can help you get items you couldn't get otherwise, which is nice. Those are the main enemies I wanted to go over. If I was going to go through them all, we would be here all day. So let's go on to the bosses, which there are a lot of. The Empress Bulblacks. This boss shows up twice, both in caves. The first time is alright, just be fast to whistle when she starts wiggling. The second time she poops. These things are called Bulbul Lava, and they can quickly get overwhelming. Plus she hits the walls, which means rocks just fall down, come from the ceiling, which isn't fun. I lost so many times the second time, and it hurt. The Burrowing Snagger is the same as Pikmin 1. Apart from there are way too many of them. They seem to be everywhere, and every single time I see them, I just go, ugh. Though, it has got me better at beating them, which is nice. The Emperor Bulblacks. This was the final boss of Pikmin 1, and it's a big joke here. Just superpower your Pikmin and or freeze him, and he's done. Even that, or just play him like any other enemy, and it's a pretty easy fight. Doesn't really stack up to the original game's version.
The Beady Long Legs. So imagine the Beady Long Legs from Pikmin 1 in a cave, and that's basically this boss. The Pikmin can attack the legs to weaken it a bit, but why would you do that when you can destroy them at the middle and do more damage faster? The Pileated Snaggret is basically the Burrowing Snaggret, but it can walk on its one leg, and it's scary as heck. But you beat it the same way as the Burrowing Snaggret, but with the extra challenge of it being able to chase you. The Man at Legs. First things first, this boss is scary and hard. When you first enter the arena, it charges up and shoots you, which shocked me at first. Trying this boss is surprisingly difficult to figure out. First, hide behind these small ledges until he's done shooting. Then throw Pikmin back while he's recharging, and once he's recharged, whistle them back and hide. Repeat. Though, looking at the ledge, it looks like you can just shoot past it, but they can't, which is really weird. Giant Breadbird, this counts as a boss apparently? He's just annoying, he just grabs the items while the Pikmin are carrying them and tries to drag them back to where they spawned. But it's really easy to defeat them because you just need to get the item in the shit and he takes full damage. The Raging Bloister, this is probably my favourite boss in the game. So what you have to do is attack the red or blue growing tail, the enemy will face the active Kampton. So you have to position the Kampton on each side of the enemy. So the boss turns around and faces that Kampton. Switch between the captains to make him turn around so you can throw Pikmin with the other captain onto him. It's really fun and easy to figure out.
The Water Wraith. From my favorite boss to my least favorite, the cave for this boss is quite unique. You have to get through the cave as fast as you can while collecting all the treasures before the wraith gets to you. But as soon as you get to the final level, you have to try and beat it. And to beat it, you are forced to use Bitter Spray. And to my knowledge, this is the only enemy that requires you to have the Bitter Spray. And you don't just need one, you need multiple. Because after I got past the first place, you're supposed to use another one, but I couldn't, because I didn't have enough. This boss just sucks. Segmented Crobster. This boss I actually forgot about until I looked it up. Shows how memorable this boss is. It's really easy, just stay away from the boss until it crashes into a wall, and then stay in between the rocks and beat the boss. And finally, the final boss. And in my opinion, it's meh. It's nothing like the frustrating difficulty of the first boss, or the amazingness of 3. For this boss called the Titan Dweevil, you find it in a cave, which is kind of disappointing. Unlike 1 where there's a small mission showing the abilities that each Pikmin have and using them to your advantage. it's just another cave, which is kinda sad. Grab everything in the cave before doing this boss, then go back up to the surface to grab all 30 yellows, 10 purples, and 20 of everything else, and then go to the boss. The boss uses elements against you through treasures, which I really like. So what you want to do is get Pikmin to get rid of the parts. So I recommend going in the arena with only yellows until you have got rid of the shock therapist, which is the electric one. Because otherwise your Pikmin can be dead in an instant, but the resistant treasures you have got throughout your adventure do not work. Must be an ultra element sort of thing. So be careful of that, your craftings can be stunlocked very easily, so just be very careful. If you just keep that in mind, this boss is pretty easy, then just save Louie and you're done with the whole game. But unlike other Pikmin games in the series, you can go back to older areas even if you have all the treasures, so that's very nice. I forgot to mention in Pikmin 2 there are a lot of treasures, and most if not all of them are based on real world objects, which is cool. Different versions will have different treasures. For example, the brand of battery has changed between Japan and America, which makes sense, but there's some differences that don't make as much sense. For example, the ice lolly stick has been changed to the tube of lipstick in Japan, which makes little sense. Plus, some of these differences aren't even consistent. Some treasures will be in different locations depending on which version you're playing, which is odd. The models aren't even different, so there's no reason for them to be put in different places. Plus, there are some treasures completely different depending on the version. For example, the treasure in Japan is called the Kitima brand milk cover, while in America, that same treasure in the same location is the Yuhu chocolate drink bottle cap, and in Europe, it is the Fritzy yogurt drink bottle cap. Plus, things cost different amounts of pokers depending on the item in each version, which is a nice attention to detail. Also, similarly to enemies and plants, Olimar and the robot have a description of the treasures. At the end of the adventure, Louie is called the King of Buzz, which is cute. It also has some dark undertones, though. In this game, there are two extra modes, which are both multiplayer. This is the first Pikmin game to actually have multiplayer, actually, and it's really fun. One mode is the competitive mode. Two-player battle. As the name suggests, it's a one-on-one. There are 10 battle maps based on different cave locations. The main goal is to retrieve 4 marbles first. There are 7 marbles in the map in random locations, so be fast on your opponent to find them. But there are other conditions to win, which include taking your opponent's colored marble back to your base. Another note about this game is that you can find cubic grenades on the ground, which can help you power up and hinder your opponent, or help yourself. These are what they are. +5/+10 sprouts, it's what it says on the tin, you get more Pikmin. Flower, all your Pikmin become flowered. Ghost, you and your Pikmin become invisible on your opponent's screen. It's kinda useful, but not very, since they can see your screen. Ultra Bitter Spray and Ultra Spicy Spray, you gain one drop of the respective thing, which is useful. The Ultra Spicy Spray is the same as in the main game. The Ultra Bitter Spray, though, can bury the opponent's Pikmin now. Marble, this returns your marble to the base if your opponent has taken it. Enemies, this will spawn the respective enemy in the opponent's base. Rocks, this will drop rocks around your opponent, crushing any Pikmin that get hit. This is a fun mode and a good competitive mode, but it's nothing compared to what's coming next. The other mode is optional co-op, and oh my goodness, this is what Cave should have been this whole time. So this new challenge mode is like Cave, but it's titled with my 3 main complaints from Caves in the main story. So there's no absolutely rubbish difficulty, but there is some, but not as much as the main game. Plus, you already have a set amount of Pikmin, so you don't have to go in, out, in, out. Secondly, there is a timer, so you have to be speedy. Thirdly, the randomness is also gone. This is what Caves should have been. This game is a long experience. After playing it, I never wanted to touch it again. 100%ing it is not a good idea. I do not think it was designed to be 100%ed, as there is no reward for 100%, and the game doesn't even have a full ending for 100%ing, at least in the main story. For a nice playthrough, I'd recommend just saving Louie, and that should be a sufficient enough playthrough for any Pikmin cravings you may have. The extra modes are nice. I love being able to play Pikmin with my friends, and not needing a second player for challenge mode is a good decision. Plus, having the caves each have a unique theme was pretty cool. In my personal opinion, this is the strongest Pikmin game in terms of pure stuff to do in the main story, as well as having a lot of extra content. but it gets beaten by the other two main games in terms of replayability and the 100%ing experience just being plain fun. Three in particular beats it in extra modes, in my personal opinion, but we will get there when we get there. This is a serviceable Pikmin experience and can be fun at points. Sometimes the game can get frustratingly difficult with the caves, but some of the highs go pretty high and the lows go down to the lowest levels. My conclusion? It's fun if you don't 100% it.